Welcome to the MBA webinar on Back to the Office. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the fall semester for those of you that students. Welcome to fall for alumni. All excited to see everybody in our webinar format. But I'm super excited to welcome two of our esteemed alumni, Ali Nemser and Lilah Jones. I'm going to ask each of them to introduce themselves. Ali first, please.
Hey, everyone. I'm Ali. I graduated from the Suffolk MBA program in 2013 and currently work as a mid-market account executive over at HubSpot. And I'm really excited to chat with you all about how we're approaching the new hybrid workplace.
Cool. Thanks, cool. Ali. Go, Lilah.
And hey, everybody, I'm Lilah Jones, and also a very proud Suffolk alumni, and I get a chance to spend my day working with awesome people at Google. I run a team there, and if I had to say what my brand is and where I add the most value, it's igniting ideas. I turn them into action, so that's how I spend my time, and I'm excited for this chat today.
Yeah, I know. It's going to be really fun. If I had a chance to hang out with Lilah and Ali, it's really fun, so I'm super excited. So what we're going to do is I'm going to talk to them, and we'll talk about, 30 minutes, and then we'll open it up for Q&A, so get your questions ready and as we're talking through. And of course, the question of the day is, back to the office, not back to the office, literally right before this webinar, my conference that was at the end of October in Georgia just got moved to virtual. And I'm like, great. I spent all that time getting all my logistics in order. Now I have to get out of order. So anyway, tell us what's going on. So Lilah, why don't you start? What's Google doing in back to the office?
What aren't we doing? Oh my goodness. We've got so many committees that are so focused on how do we land this for all of our employees, right? How do we make sure that it's inclusive for women? How do we make sure it's inclusive for those with disabilities? How do we make sure we're inclusive for those who don't want to get the vaccine, right? How are we going to manage that? So we've had all kinds of focus groups and surveys to try to figure out where's the baseline of needs for our population. And so some may know that we were supposed to go back to the office in September. That has now been moved out based on a number of things that I'm sure we'll talk about as we go through these questions until next year in January. So it has just been a really interesting time.
Yeah, my son is a coder for Microsoft, and they were supposed to go back to the office in October. Now they've come back with indefinite. Oh, wow. Not even committing. Yeah. Ali, what are you seeing at HubSpot?
It sounds like we're doing a lot of the things that are similar to what Lilah mentioned. We've created a culture that is very much remote inclusive, have been working on different ways to make remote HubSpotters feel like they are right in the middle of everything, from virtual inclusive events to our hiring process and everything in between. So been really interesting to see how we've adapted. And I think that it's, only going to keep continuing to be that hybrid model.
Yeah. It's so funny. We are back on campus. I actually taught on campus last year, but all my students were online. So it was me and my tech producer in the classroom by ourselves. So it was really like being online. I was just in a different location. But now I'm back on campus, and I got to tell you, the first couple of classes, there was this joy in the classroom, and not just for me. There was joy from me being in the classroom. It was joy from the students being in the classroom, and it was palpable. But I'm also enjoying not going in 4 days, 5 days a week, right? I'm going in 3 days a week, which is making a difference. So what are you both doing? What are the choices that you're making right now? And what did you make, during COVID? How is it changing? Lilah, go ahead.
Well, I will say that I have the option to go into the office now. And it's similar to kind of what you might think. And anybody been to a Google office is phenomenal, right? At least, it's got everything. It's like you want to be there because it's like the world comes to you. Well, it's not that way anymore because COVID had to stop a lot of our services. So I kind of always have this ROI metric, like, is what I'm going to accomplish in the office worth the extra 2 hours? Now, even though I don't live 2 hours away, when you factor in getting dressed, getting on the train, walking to the office, it's 2 hours. And so I always have this kind of line in the sand of, what am I going to accomplish? And is there an ROI for that? And it's interesting because what I've found is that I would like the couple times I've gone to the office, I'm just not as effective. Like, I'm not as productive. I'm like, wow, this is taking so much longer. Where in like probably 2 seconds from my small home office / closet. So it's certainly, Jodi, a balancing act.
Yeah.
It's a balancing act that I don't know how it's going to land, but I can say this, I'm certainly more disconnected from feeling like I need to be there in order to be productive.
And do you find you miss it when you're there? You miss being home when you're at work, and you miss being at work when you're at home? Because I find that to be the truth sometimes.
It depends. I will say that during COVID, when everyone was home, I was like happy to be anywhere but here, because there was always like Wi-Fi bandwidth contention, and then you had to like make deals with the kids on which hours they were going to play Roblox and which ones. They- really, really challenging. Yeah. I would say now that they're all back to school and out of the house, it's just as great sometimes to work here if I really need to get, high focus type of work done.
Very cool. Very cool. Ali, what about you?
I'm a little bit different in a sense that I love being in the office. HubSpot also does a really great job of making you want to be there. Prior to the pandemic, you would be able to come in, bring your pups in, and it's great. And I personally thrive off of others and the collaboration among teams. That said, during the pandemic, I had planned to be a full-time in-office employee. I love having a dedicated desk, my laptop, my monitor, all of my stuff there. But in a positive turn, I ended up getting a little puppy who I'm very excited about. But due to some of the rolling out of pre-pandemic amenities, we're not currently bringing dogs in the office. So while I potty trained my corgi from home when my boyfriend luckily can also work home sometimes, so we try to switch it off that way I can go in once in a while, but at least for the near future I'm still primarily working in the office, in my home office, but I do plan to go in full time. I love it, and I have about a 10 minute walk commute. Can't complain too much about that.
Yeah, that's really interesting, because I think what's happening is, just like you heard from the three of us, we have very different, whatever we want, very different things, right? And there's some crossover, there's some Venn diagram going on here. But here's the, it's interesting, because I was just reading an article, there was this big expose on getting women back to work, because as you know, women were big losers in the job situation during COVID for a myriad of reasons, and low-income women took the biggest brunt of all because most of their jobs disappeared. But this particular article is really talking about how they wanted this inclusive piece, which both of you even mentioned, the remote inclusive and the baseline inclusiveness. The thing is, though, this particular company has a policy that says if one person is remote, then everybody, you run the meeting remote. So that everybody gets on. And we know from, plenty of team research that this actually makes a difference, because remote, if unless the majority of people are online, remote becomes, you forget about people. You totally forget that they're there because you're so engaged in the moment. What are each of your companies doing about this? Ali, I'll start with you. Are your companies doing anything about that to try to be inclusive of people who are remote or not remote, and how you blend that all together? What are you saying? Yeah.
So we really are, and even prior to the pandemic, we started embracing more of this remote culture. A lot of HubSpotters are working remote. It's something that every employee has the option to do. So I think we were in a really good spot in a sense that our company had been going in that direction. Obviously, the pandemic really took it all and ramped everything up. So now everything is remote and virtually inclusive, whether it be team meetings. All team meetings are on Zoom. Events, any of our upcoming inbound event, where typically we've got 40,000 people who fly to Boston now and last year, all virtual. So we've really been embracing it and trying to make everything as virtually inclusive as we can. Even the hiring and new hire training processes have adapted. So I think we're doing a really good job of it. I personally don't feel like my day-to-day has changed or any of the positives that I enjoy at HubSpot from a culture standpoint. I don't feel like there's been any change, because we've been focusing so much on remote.
Oh, that's really impressive, actually. Because a lot of people feel this cultural loss a real sense of loss because they're missing some of it. So that's impressive. They've been able to do it. Lilah, what have you seen?
So similar type of a rollout as far as making sure that all meetings are inclusive. We've actually changed, and I don't know if everybody else has this, but like in G Suite or Workspace now, when you say you're going to, in our version of it, when you say you're going to attend a meeting, you have the option to click virtual or in person.
Oh, that's cool.
Every single meeting that you accept or decline, you can decide like, how do I want to show up for this meeting as opposed to just having accept, right? That way we can have an idea of how many people are virtual, like the meeting organizer, and we can make, for instance, let's say we're going to do a happy hour, right? There's a lot of happy hours. Let's get the team together or do some kind of a dinner. If we notice that most people are going to be virtual, then we might do some type of a virtual event, right? Where people can have engagement virtually as well. So perhaps we do both. We do the happy hour and for everybody's going to be virtual. We, you know, use a company called Teamaraderie that can, you know, send everybody a bottle of wine. They can do a tasting remote so that they still feel, and we make sure a leader is also remote so that they don't feel like they're not getting the FaceTime. And that works out really well for some people because you know what? They don't want to spend 2 hours in a happy hour with you.
Right.
They do want to be able to have opportunities. I can still spend 2 hours, right? I can spend 45 minutes and do the exact same thing, right? Crazy, but there's a lot of people that just, they prefer to be at home and have dinner with their family than sit in a car with you, right?
Yeah. Well, I think that's the thing. It's like, I think there's this nesting. I don't know what else to call it, this return to home. But I want to build on your point about leadership, because I think this is a really key point. I was just at another webinar, and they were talking about, I was talking about the fact that there's a lot of leaders who are very uncomfortable with remote work. And clearly, I don't think that's the case of your two organizations, but in a lot of organizations, for example, Jamie Dimon of JP Morgan basically said, everybody will be coming back. And so you see these dictates from above. And from what I'm seeing, it seems to be because a lot of leaders are really uncomfortable with this. And of course, in the same Wall Street Journal piece, they were talking about the fact that if you have, so in this article, 57% of men wanted to work remote, you know, 2 to 3 days a week, 67% of women wanted the same. So there's a real differential. And if you have leaders who believe that this face-to-face time is so important, that's going to be a criteria for promotion. So how are your organizations thinking about their role modeling as a leader so that they don't become remote is sort of secondary? Are you thinking about that? Is Google talking about that at all, Lilah?
So it's interesting because when you think about promotion and building your career, we try not to make it on things that are super logistic driven. It's always results driven, results and impact driven. We have very specific attributes and metrics and what we call OKR, measurable outcomes,
right,
that dictate that. Now, how you get those, right? So hopefully we're hoping that that will continue to be the basis for how people progress in their career. That being said, our leaders are challenged as well, right? Because this whole idea of butts and seats, very industrial revolution, right?
I mean, it's like, oh my God.
We're no longer factory workers. And the truth is, this is my opinion. The opinion around that for myself and many others is it's the control. If I can keep your butt in the seat, then I can control your inputs. Right. A lot of times culture is simply, you know, kind of whatever the rituals are that you do as an organization. And it's got a lot to do with control. And so now, especially in our world, it's very difficult, especially as somebody that's revenue generating, right, to say you need to be where an office is or you need to be here, when the truth is our customers are everywhere.
Right.
Right. And this will continue to be a trend, especially amongst what we call digital natives. Digital natives are non-traditional companies. So they're companies that are kind of born and, you know, using all digital types of technologies. Those folks are everywhere. They're everywhere. Nobody is sitting, if your headquarters is in Chicago, all your executives and all your people sit here. So since that is already a thing of the past, it is going to require that everybody adapt.
Yeah. I'd love it too, because I think what this happens is that we shift from a leadership focus to a customer focus, which is where everybody says they want to be and where we really do need to be. And I think by shifting the power like that, you actually start to be where the customers are, and you don't have to be where the leaders don't matter. But the only way that works is if the organization then rewards according to that. If they still reward as in butts and seats, then that's the behavior you're going to get. What are you seeing, Ali, at HubSpot?
I think that similar to what Lilah said, there is a lot that at HubSpot that we do to make sure that your progression, your career isn't dictated by that. So, having attributes that we're testing for during the interview process for both remote and HubSpot employees. So I don't think that it's having an impact on someone's ability to progress in their career. One thing that I feel has led to HubSpot being really successful in this transition and managers being effective in leading remote teams is that there is an entire remote spot internal wiki where there are resource leaders, everything from the manager lifecycle field guide, remote edition, right, to connections with remote employees, even things like how you can be a better virtual manager or host remote inclusive events. So anytime that you might be thinking, how do I better lead my team through this? Or how can I take these things that were really effective in managing in person and translate it to virtual? I think that we've just done a really good job here at arming leaders at HubSpot and all employees really with guidance on how to best do that, which I've personally seen be really effective.
Well, that's one of the key ingredients. Go ahead, sorry, Lilah, go ahead.
I just want to build on what Ali said. If you juxtapose that type of flexibility from a leadership perspective and, hey, we're going to try to make sure that it's equitable and not doing this mandated you must, I think that the outcome could potentially be what we're seeing fuel what is called, I'm sure you've heard this, the great resignation.
Yeah, exactly.
People had enough. Exactly. Right? People had enough. And they're like, I'm not doing that. What COVID has taught me is that I can retool and refigure and find another way to make money. I don't have to just take the inputs from the five people that I've been around for the last 5 years, right?
Exactly.
And so I think that if people, the outcome of not getting this right, the outcome is going to be a talent, probably a gap in the talent pipelines because people have options now, right? Yep. And I think that we're going to see them take that. And for companies that don't get it or try to mandate, I think they're going to see a loss of talent because people who are talented can go elsewhere.
Well, and I always say that too. I say, and when you think of loss of talent, it isn't your worst employees that are leaving. It's your best employees. So you got to figure out who you want to keep because your best employees, they're out of here. They're just saying, hasta luego, you know, they don't have time for it. And I think it's a beautiful thing because it sort of is a strong market signal that is hard to ignore.
You know, the other thing that we've noticed, and this is not from a leadership perspective, but just in conversations, you know, people say, yeah, obviously I miss being in the office and the connection, but the truth is you could have connection with people, it just takes a little bit more effort, right? And it can be you can be much more mindful and intentional. The other thing is some people are like, you know, I really can do my job in 3 days a week. I can. There's a whole bunch of studies out there talking about the four-day work week or working. If I cut out all the non-essential meetings and if I cut out all the things that honestly, I'm just kind of tagging along with, I don't need to be there. If I cut out the commuting and I really just focus on the work that's going to move the ball forward, I can do this in 3 days a week. Yeah. I can. And I think that's a beautiful thing.
And why not, right? It's like, why not allow people to make the self-determination about what it is? I was just telling somebody, it's like, when you do a mandate from above, you're basically telling everybody, I don't trust you. I don't know that it's to your point control, and therefore I don't want you to do it. Whereas if you give people the flexibility to make decisions about where they're going to remote work or how they're going to work, you're giving them the trust and the autonomy to make the decisions that they want. That is a powerful signal to employees, and people want to stay in that because they feel valued. And so I think that there's this whole transition. And this has been going on for a long time in command control leadership, which has shifted. And I think your two organizations really are role modeling some of this. Ali, I don't know if you have any thoughts on what you're seeing in terms of this at HubSpot.
Yeah, no, I mean, I couldn't agree more. I think that one of my favorite things at HubSpot is the fact that every new HubSpotter comes in and the first thing that you do is read the culture code, right? And so you come into the organization having an understanding that no one is going to hover over you and micromanage you. And we have a saying that we say, UGJ, use good judgment, right? And that's kind of the overarching way that we all operate. And I think that just inherently having that baked into the culture from day one, you you've got this autonomy that actually allows you to do your best work. And I feel like that's been something we've done really well for years. What COVID has allowed us to really do is take it to that next level and say, now you're not expected in any way, shape or form to come in the office. It is completely up to you. And so now you can really UGJ, whether it be at home or in the office. And as long as you're, you know, operating in the way that is expected, you never have to worry about someone above you coming down on you for your choice. And it's just
really tapping you on the shoulder.
Right. And it allows you to focus on what's important at work, right? I don't have to decide between going to, you know, get a physical and completing my job, because I know that as long as I'm getting these things done, I can, you know, fit my day, schedule my day the way that works best for me.
Yeah.
So it's just incredibly freeing. And I think that a lot of companies that aren't operating in this way are certainly going to see the effects.
Yeah, I love the word freeing, because that's exactly what it feels like. Lila, I think you wanted to come in.
What I was going to say is, you know, I was doing some discussions around this, and I was wondering, I was like, why would a company mandate something like that? Or why wouldn't everybody just say, fine, go remote, right? Like, what is really the downside besides the loss of control, besides all these things? They also haven't had to spend as much in office costs. There haven't been anywhere near as many challenges from an HR perspective. Like, there's all kinds of things that are automatically done with when you have a more remote culture. And one of the things I was helped to appreciate is it has to do a lot with government. So Jamie Dimon, or anybody who's in charge of a large corporation. Well, they are assuming, and they've probably gotten tax breaks and different things like that, based on the fact that I'm going to have a certain number of workers who are going to live here. States make decisions based on that, on how they're going to staff schools, how they're going to staff all of these civil types of services based on the number of employees that you have there. I know State Farm, which is a big company in Bloomington, Illinois, they are 100% tied to what's going on in the state of Illinois, because, you know, they're the number one employer in a certain area. And so one of the reasons why I feel like, you know, is certainly something that's overlooked as to why organizations haven't come out and said, you know what, instead of pushing RTO back 8 times, we're just remote, you know, for a while, is because there are absolutely different types of metrics that they have for employing workers. Because if you could choose to work in New York, which is super expensive, or work in, I don't know, maybe Austin, Texas, where there's no income tax, which one are you going to choose?
Exactly.
Right. And so they're trying to keep us from having that kind of mass exodus from some of these cities, where the only thing that's keeping people here, me included, is, you know, opportunity.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's absolutely a good point. Massachusetts and New Hampshire were in a lawsuit over that, where, you know, which state do you pay the tax to when you work remote? So I don't know exactly what the status of that is, but I think that makes a really good point. I think another element is the fact that a lot of organizations have not been set up from an outcome-based, you know, talk about the OKR or the KPI or whatever the measurement tool is of success. Oftentimes, organizations don't know how to measure that. So how do your organizations measure that you're being effective? Ali, what do you see at HubSpot?
So being in the sales org, for us, we've always been very metric driven around revenue that each individual is bringing in, as well as the teams and segments as a whole. So I think that for us, it's a little unique in the sense that we are very much, you know, benchmarking our revenue and metrics around that. So other departments in HubSpot, I know that they operate a little bit differently. I think that, you know, product and design, of course, are going to have different metrics than marketing. So I can't speak too much to the other organizations, but I'd say in HubSpot, at least on the sales side of things, it's very much been the same metrics that we used before, which I think did make it a little easier for us to measure, you know, how effective people are in or outside of the office.
Yeah, sales is always easy to measure, right?
Revenue.
Lila, you notice anything at
I was. So similar to LA, you know, obviously I'm, you know, revenue producing org, it's always tied to revenue. But what I've seen is for some of our folks in finance, certainly some of our folks in HR, certainly some of our folks that are in product management, we still have, you know, our core, which is our OKRs, which is, you know, Sundar Pichai, which is our CEO, will say, here's the things that are important. And that kind of trickles down to the organization. And so regardless of whether you're impacting revenue or not, you're going to have, you know, these four measurable outcomes that are in your business unit, that whether you did a good job or not, right? And then there's certainly compensation that comes in the forms of bonuses and things like that around there. I also get a chance to talk to a lot of non-tech companies, obviously, with what I do. And I often ask, you know, you can ask a senior executive, well, how are you measured? And they might say, well, it's on EBITDA. Or how are you measured? Oh, well, it's on outcomes based on this. But oftentimes you can talk to a person and say, how are you measured? When do you know you're successful in your job? And they can't answer you.
Yes.
And so what I'm hoping that this could possibly inform is for folks to take a really hard look at, what do you do for a living? Is it a measurable outcome? Does it matter if you do it or not? And if you don't, if you can't answer those questions in a way that it's convincing to you, that might be a really great indicator that it's time to do something different. Because those roles that don't have measurable impact, it doesn't just be in sales, right? In any function, I would say, are always at risk, regardless of COVID and RTO.
Yeah, no, I think that's true. I think it's very true. So we're gonna start opening up for questions. So start throwing in your questions in the Q&A or in the chat area, and we'll start answering them while we're waiting for questions to come in. We've got there's always the lazy employee syndrome. Like, this is, I think everybody's fear is that the majority of employees are going to be lazy. But what are you seeing? I mean, how are the lazy factor, or the person that's not contributing to their best ability to the team, how are they managed at your organization? Let's start with Lilah.
Well, it's tough to be lazy at Google, right? you're going to get sniffed out, and it's going to show. And that's not just for sales org. It's in any org. It's pretty competitive. And so the people that tend to be what we'll call performers that need some additional help, we have a performance program that kind of helps us either liberate them or help them continue to engage. And we do that either by giving them a low performance rating, and then they have the opportunity to get that twice before they're offered liberation, or figure it out and improve. Certainly, this idea of remote working being an indicator or something that's going to make a lazy person lazier, we've not seen that. We've still seen people produce at the same level, probably more.
The data says people are more productive. Yeah.
So that, as a, oh my gosh, it's going to make lazy people lazier, is also from the Industrial Revolution, because they've still got this mindset of a blasted time clock. A lot of you probably aren't even old enough to know what a time clock is. Hard, and you would, and I don't know, make a widget and eat your lunch on the widget maker, and that's okay. But that's not our current, and it's not our future. And so we really have to disconnect and have some change around that mindset.
Yeah. What do you think, Ali?
It sounds very similar to Google. To Lilah's point, it's very hard to be lazy at HubSpot. I think that, you know, from a KPI standpoint, every department and every role has their metrics that they know they're going to be measured on. For our sales, obviously, there are certain metrics that if you don't adhere to them, or if you fall below, you're going to be triggered for a performance plan. And in which case, you've got a set plan of things that you need to do in a certain amount of time. Otherwise, to borrow your term, you'll be, you know, we can liberate you. And in other departments, right, they all have their own metrics and performance review cycles in which you can identify those who might not be pulling their weight or the standards that we set. So I think that we've seen as an organization just a tremendous amount of growth during the last, you know, during the last year or so. So I don't think that we've seen any sort of increase in laziness. I would say that if anything, it just reminds people that you need to be responsible and that you need to be an adult. We're fortunate that everybody works at HubSpot primarily. Everybody wants to be here, right? So that's
exactly
part of it too.
Cool. So we've got a question. Working at a company where some jobs must be on site or in person, this person works in healthcare, they struggle to have fair and equity policy on remote hybrid work. Any guidance or thoughts on navigating it? Also complex staffing groups as well. You got any ideas? Like, so basically you've got some people that have to be there because of their job and some people who have more flexibility. How do you provide equity? Any thoughts on that? That's a complicated question.
When you say equity, of course, this is a back, any good consultant answers with a question. When you say equity, what does that mean? Does that mean job equity, pay equity? You know,
well, I think at this point, it's probably just remote work is still considered a perk, I think, in many organizations. And so if people don't have the ability to do it, they feel like they're being punished or they're not, oh, I don't have that ability, that type of thing. So I think it's equity in that sense.
I get it. And so I've had a lot of people that I've talked to who've had this challenge, right? And clearly, if you've got a job where you're serving the public, this is going to be tough, right? I mean, you have to be there to serve. So that I would just say that there's some table stakes there, but assuming you're not serving the direct public or you're not what do you call the workers that were super
frontline
worker, then there's certainly a conversation that can be had. And while your broader organization may say, this is our mandate, I have had a lot of people that I've gotten a chance to spend time with who've had a one-on-one with their manager saying, I'm more effective this way. I've been able to produce everything that I need to.
Yeah.
And you know, this is what I'd like to see moving forward, right? And give and kind of create their own working contract with their superiors or their managing teams and speak up for what they want. And I've seen that go really, really well
for people.
I haven't heard anybody who didn't get a good result from that.
Yeah, I have seen that as well. And then what I often tell people is, and then measure the productivity and then go shout the story to the wind so that everybody can hear how well it worked so that you can actually bring that privilege to other people. Ali, you want to add anything?
I mean, I'm right there with you both. I think that there are certain jobs where it's inherently going to be in person. If you're a physical therapist or you're a nurse, you're not going to be able to do something like that remote, probably. Although, I mean, even those professions, I know I did some physical therapy over Zoom.
But
I did when it was bad and I had a few years recovering from. That's the downside of being a dancer is that you do virtual Zoom PT when you have to. But I think that, you know, if you have a role where you're being required to actually be in office and you feel as though you could do a remote and could be equally, if not more effective, I'm of the thought that document, right? Take data, quantify your time, quantify the results, and then have a conversation. And if it's something that you're having a conversation internally and leadership isn't open to, you know, that might be a sign that maybe a culture that is more open to new ideas and change might be a good fit.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, I'm a big fan of anything you can quantify before bringing it up. It just makes your case stronger.
Yeah.
Back to the great resignation. Lots of people are doing this. They're saying I can be effective where I am. And companies are like, well, no, Bob or Jerry, they've worked here for 75 years and they don't want anything different. And they're saying, great, see ya.
Yeah.
See ya.
Gotta go because somebody else does. We have another question. The question is, can you ask about remote work in an interview? And what do you think about what that looks like? I'm sure you've hired people. What are you noticing? Are people willing to ask that? Is it still risky to ask that question? Or are people just saying, precisely to the great resignation point, no, I'm going to ask it because it's a key criteria to me working. Are you seeing anything different?
I think that at HubSpot, because we're actively promoting it, it hasn't been something that anyone is steering away from. We're actively encouraging those questions. And if you go to the HubSpot career page, you'll see that we're very much advertising that you have the ability to choose what's going to be best for you and make you the most effective employee. So I certainly, as somebody who interviews candidates externally, one of the things which gets brought up in conversations is, you know, how do you actually feel with remote work? Do people find that they lose out on the culture if they opt in? So I have noticed that as much as we're promoting it, it gets the dialogue going and the questions are less about, is this okay? And more about, is it really as good as you say it is, or as your website says it is? To which I respond, absolutely. You know, there's things that are going to be pros and cons, but I think that you know, the water coolers, the happy hours, the virtual events are certainly, you know, not slowing down here, but yeah. So yeah, I would say it's changing the nature of the questions more than anything.
Oh, interesting. Very interesting. Are you seeing any difference?
I would say that the question we typically get is, are you an in-office culture, right? That's a way to ask.
Interesting. That's a good way.
Yeah, without having to be like, I'm not planning on coming in, right? So are you a in-office culture? And that usually gives us the opportunity to say, we're hybrid, which we haven't actually tried yet, but we're piloting. and so that's how I've seen that question come up. The thing I've seen the most important on location and in office versus not office is compensation, right?
Ooh, so talk about that, yes.
Are living in, with Google, right? You got a lot of people who live in the Bay Area, is wicked expensive.
Yeah, really.
The Boston terms. And so it's interesting that, you know, people are like, hey, I'm 30 years old and I've got three roommates in downtown San Francisco because it's so expensive. I can move to Alabama, which I can't tell you how many folks are choosing to move to Alabama because I can get a house, a mansion for 200 grand and I can still do my job from there, right? Yeah. Well, then how do you pay that person, right? Am I now less valuable and should make less money because I live in Alabama?
Yeah.
Should I? And so that's why people are having this great debate, because if I move to Alabama and say, this is where I'm currently going to be, then you're going to cut my salary and pay me for that market. That's very common, right? That's a very in-office, you know, you're built, you know, the salaries are different based on where you live. Well, that's got to be overhauled. It's just be based on my output, not on where I live, because as we go into being more remote, it's going to be difficult to have those qualifiers to say, well, my work is less valuable to the company in Alabama than it was in San Francisco. That doesn't make any sense. And so that's where I've really seen this whole idea of in-office versus not come down to dollars and cents.
Yep. Yeah, I think that's going to get more and more complicated, because I don't think that's going to go away in the short term. It's a very hard minefield to manage, I think. It's going to be interesting to see how that unfolds. We have time for one more question, and it's here. What can universities do to better prepare students for this new way of working? Should they be modeling this in their own operations? Any thoughts on that? Because you're hiring on the other side. What are us people on this side? What should we be doing?
I'll let Ali go first. I've got perspective, but I talk a lot.
No, that's a really thoughtful question. I would say that, you know, right now I don't think that this generation has any trouble with like operating Zoom or actually like being on camera, right? So I don't think that that would be the area of focus. I would say more on how to better collaborate with team members cross-functionally. How do you branch out and network when you're not able to meet somebody in the cafeteria? How do you, you know, proactively network and become close and reach out to people from other departments when you are finding them on Slack or getting an intro? So I would say less about the actual like day-to-day of virtual or remote working, and more about how do you transfer these communication skills that you're, you know, that everybody is working to develop now, and transfer it to a virtual organization or a remote. Remote role. That would be the thing that I've seen as being the hardest, and also something that I've personally seen an area that, as a good communicator, having to, you know, reach out and help new hires ramp up and just feel part of the culture. So
yeah, that makes sense. Actually, that's very thoughtful. And very, because it shifts it away from, oh, remote. It's about these fundamental skills, and you're supplying them in a different form. I like that thinking. Lilah.
So I would agree. And I would add that if people can end the sentence, I've had a wonderful educational experience. It was hybrid, which means I wasn't on the campus all the time. I went maybe once or twice to do a simulation or something like that. And I still feel like I had an amazing experience. Then they'll no longer tie in person or remote to satisfaction, because that's just a learned behavior. You learn to tie those things together, and they may or may not be associated. You can still experience a lot of these same things if we're mindful about how, you know, what experience we're giving to our students. And so I would say, A, stop marrying happiness and engagement and satisfaction with remote, right? And then B, certainly what Ali mentioned is, how do we then start to do this, you know, idea of having meaningful connection and interaction that's, you know, super thoughtful, right? It's not going to happen on random. You're not going to get lucky and just happen to be walking to the parking lot. So now how do we teach these skills so that you can still have that level? And the truth interaction, and the truth is your world just became bigger.
Yeah.
Right. The optimist in me says the world just became bigger. You're no longer tied to just the five people who are around your cubicle. Because the truth is, even though we want to say, yeah, you know, when I was in the office, I had all the opportunities in the world. No, you talk to the same five people. Now you have an opportunity to expand that. And so yeah. I think if you can't hear, I'm a huge fan of remote. I like it and I'm an ambassador for it and will continue to be.
Yeah, I am too. I like the hybrid. I'm a huge fan of the hybrid. I like both. What about you, Allie? You said you're the in-person fan?
I let me put an asterisk next to that. I'm an in-person fan on days that I'm an in-person fan. I like knowing that I have my place. And if I go to my desk, I've got my nice little stash of candy. I also like days where it's terrifying. But I also very much appreciate the days where I wake up and do not want to wear pants or actually like be around the person. So I do like it. I think that the knowing in the back of my mind that if I don't want to go in today for whatever reason, no one is going to be tapping on my shoulder or, you know, sending me a text. I think that that's what I really like. It is having that, you know, that flexibility, but
yeah. Yes, we get to choose for ourselves. Well, Lilah and Ali, it has been so fun talking with you. And thank you for sharing your experiences, both personal and professional. Hopefully our alumni and students really got a lot out of it. I did, and actually it was a lot of fun too. So thank you, and have a wonderful day, everybody.